stand.
Stand. Only three of the lights in this room work. Okay. So I had to be strategic where I stand. So excuse the walking around. That's not part of the performance, that's me being able to read. The following text is an overview of my research practice so far. It's at once a document of things that have taken place practically and a piece of practice in itself. In the act of writing, reflecting on experience, knowledge reveals itself that keeps the subject of what is being written about continually evolving. This is key to my research process. So in writing this, I'm reading it at this event, I intend for this text content to reveal things in the process of our dialogue with one another that will begin to give agency to our individual and collective positions. My research began with the exploration of place and the movements within place that give it expression of space. This conceptualization of space as practice place is taken from Michel Certeau's employment of structuralist frameworks in an understanding of the dynamics of the practices of everyday life. Initially, I viewed the gestures, movements, and conversations of everyday life as performative attempts to locate a sense of self, specific to that moment in a particular place. For the research, I wanted to explore how a reworking of these practices might provide material for performance, and in turn perhaps reveal things about the place it gave rise to. I perceived these moments and conversation as the spatial determinants that give expression to the language of place, to use Michel de Certeau's phrasing. In the observation of these practices, I explore the spatial determinants by which individuals attempt to locate themselves and are located in everyday places, exposing and reconfiguring these social practices to evoke a reimagining of social space. This is still very much the aim of the research, but the studies deepened and altered slightly in response to research already undertaken. The research does indeed still explore how reimagining of people, of how people perform to reconstruct agency in place, giving a question into the potential of place as a locator agency, and in reciprocation, agency as a locator of place. What has evolved from research so far has led to the development of a practice that explores how a reciprocal relationship between artist as observer, the place being observed, and the subsequent articulation of the experience of place in dialogue with an audience can produce aesthetic and conceptual forms, or to put it in the context of the research, site-specific biological processes. It was in the practice of articulating my research to an audience that the concept of a performative layer of agency across places and times revealed itself. This research began to uncover a practice that exposed issues of ethics, identity, and authorship in the layers of form that evolved through the experience of place communicated in dialogue. If place is to be considered a concept that contains evolving layers, then conceptually places are in constant movement. So to understand place as a moving concept, a perpetual deferring of location takes place. In acknowledging a continual deferral of a fixed or substantive location, destabilised through the understandings of our experiences of being together, and exploring the potential of a practice that deliberately plays with the locational and authorial instability in establishing agencies of audience, artist, and place. This is to propose a dialogue of everyday experience that gives artistic form to experiential dialogue and provides a performative space for the agency. To perform dialogue is to provide a structured space where the honesty of experience can be accessed and the performance of an experimental social dynamics can be encouraged to destabilise these structures. To posit methodologies in this way evokes theories of post-structuralism and positions research in a territory where visual arts meets performance and live art. This has its roots in the practices of the late 50s and 60s, where artists sought to employ actions and movements observed in everyday life, playing them out in places that provoked a question of aesthetic form and locational propriety. The position of the audience in relation to artists in place has been arguably indeterminate ever since in countless works that blur collaborative boundaries. Site-specific art has its roots in the many interdisciplinary practices that built from the foundation to the point where the term site is used to refer to anything from the body to physical buildings to mental and virtual spaces and beyond. Nick Kay's reading of site specificity supports the initial theoretical foundation for research. Kay begins with 1960s conceptualism and minimalist sculpture to outline where he perceives visual art enters the theatrical in the location of the artwork, and in that the location of the artwork becomes a process born of the relationship between the viewer, object or event, and the place of experience. Read in these terms, site becomes a process or concept and not a fixed location. And this instigates an exploration of the specifics of these processes that form a concept of site in the context of everyday interactions. Kay's position that the reading of a site-specific piece of art emphasises a reliance on a semiotic system that brings together the history and identity of the viewer, the form of the art object or event.
And a location to produce meaning. If any element is affected, that's interesting, then the work becomes something else,
Kay writes, and I quote, "Indeed, where the location of the signifier may be read as being performed by the reader, then the functioning of language provides an initial model for performance of place." This is taken from his book, Site-Specific Art, Performance, Place, and Documentation. He uses Jacques Derrida's critique of stable binary opposites as structures that stabilize meaning. Moving beyond the structuralist model employed by Ferdinand Saussure, stable binary opposites are structures that stabilize meaning, moving beyond the structuralist model employed by Ferdinand Saussure.
So a critique of artworks that are closer to a post-structuralist meaning. The work that Kay uses as examples defies straightforward closed systems of meaning in their ability to shift perspectives of when the work begins and ends and where it is situated, if situated anywhere at all. Through this post-structuralist lens, I propose situations that make locating a fixed place for the work problematic. Answer with the video. He says, through this post-structuralist lens, I propose situations that make locating a fixed place for the work problematic. I'm interested in questioning where the role of the artist is activated, and where the positions of artist and audience reside in the process of dialoguing and the everyday experiences of place. Derrida writes about a supplement, the notion that something is never whole in and of itself, but merely constituent of that other than itself. And through difference is given identity. My research is revealing things about me and my audience that gives each of us agency. The revelation of our agency both gives the artwork form, and in turn, the form of the artwork gives us agency. A methodological process has developed that begins with the observation of everyday places and proceeds to dialogue experience through a site-specific arts practice. The problematics of the term site-specific are well articulated in art theory by writers like Nguyen Quan and Grant Kester. And within site-specificity, sit terms like site-responsive, conversational, community, and dialogical art. The research adds to this field by taking a post-substantive approach to the production of art forms that reveal agency in the dynamics of dialogue and everyday practices of place.
Just clarify the term post-substantive there. That term came about in conversation with another PhD student at Roe Hampton, who described my practice. She was putting some of my work into a journal, and she described my practice as post-substantive. And to my knowledge, that's not been used before, so I attribute that to her, Mariella Grill.
Derrida suggests that speech is closer to true thought than writing. So speech gives consciousness form that can be shared with others, whereas writing is merely a representation of this. There we go, look.
Oh, he's going
to never booking him again. He claims that Western philosophy has privileged speech over writing and his exemplary absence, whereas speech relies on the presence of the speaker. My research seeks to give form to my experiences of everyday practices of place. So one of the problems is how to represent this in a form as true to my experience as possible. That's fine as it was, I'm sorry, I was
using my own agency.
Even this is problematic though, in that this statement suggests that there is a truth inherent in my experience, but giving form to this problem is part of my research. This leads adopting a methodology where I look, hear, and feel, generating thoughts as a consequence of the experience of looking, hearing, and feeling. I then have to somehow document the experience with the intention of somehow articulating the document through a form of art, whether performance, moving image, or written text. These forms bring with them their own problems in terms of ethics, representation, and truth. If I was to take Derrida's position that writing is a representation of pure thought, then to write down the thoughts of my experience would be to falsify them. To record the movements of the people I observe without their knowledge is also perhaps unethical. But to inform them of my position as an onlooker would further falsify notions of performative truth and authenticity. It is in dialogue with an audience that these problems reveal themselves and allow a social spatial discourse to occur. Last year I showed a performative piece entitled Refining a Sense of Space, where I documented my experience of being in a cafe, then retold the specifics of the experience to an audience. I showed the filmed moving image document of the cafe combined with some type of text taken from written accounts of the experience I've had there that I'd written in the moment of being in the cafe. I mixed this with audio recordings of what I'd heard there. All of these documents have been recorded at different times in the same place. I spoke words of accompaniment to these documents. These words were rather a process of remembering what I'd experienced, but the specifics of this oral account were a combination of what I knew then and what I was in the process of knowing in that moment of communicating with the audience. There were layers to the piece that were specific to locations beyond the cafe or the space I was performing in. The presence of my audience affected my account and my observations of those I witnessed in the initial encounter in the cafe. I made a video document of this performance, which contained a conversation with the audience at the end. I listened to the words that were spoken in dialogue, which I then transcribed. This text was evidence of our presence together at the moments the words were spoken, but the text was also evidence of the absence of that same audience manifested in actions of me transcribing the text. Faced with the words of others in written form, I then gave them breath once more, myself, reading them out with the audio recording of the actual interlocutors playing in accompaniment. This practice of trying to know more about a place through the processes and documents of dialogue gave me a sense of agency born of these events and place. Dory Massey writes, quote, "If space is rather a spontaneity of stories so far, then place the collections of those stories, articulations within the wider power geometries of space. Their character will be a product of these intersections within that wider setting and what is made of them." And two of the non-meetings are the disconnections and the relations not established, the exclusions. All this contributes to the specific.